Well, here we are. It's early November 2021, and we've stalled out on a bunch of our projects, so we're changing. We're changing our focus, not changing our focus here, but when I started this back up this time, I'm changing the way I'm approaching this idea that we're trying to convert, or we're trying to take BR accuracy ideas and move them over to other arenas. I've showed you my barrel shank ideas. One of the things I haven't really showed you yet is how we intend to hold these into the stocks. And now I'm at the point, I've touched a little bit. I have this stock over here, which is, see if I can get that thing to focus. I think I'm gonna have to go to manual. Okay, I've showed you about the chassis system, something that you guys can do when you're building. I just pre-bedded this chassis in recently so that now it aligns perfectly. One of the things I'm going to do today is seal this all up, clean it up, and dribble in from the top. You see all those? I'm going to dribble epoxy into here and forevermore epoxy this chassis into the stock. Today is my day for setting up a bunch of these stocks. For rigidity, for stiffness. What we're trying to do here is achieve the rigidity, the stiffness, the feedback, the tuning that's available on a bench rest setup in which the action is glued in. But what we don't want is to have the action glued in. So today I'm going to go through. We already know what we're doing on that left-handed situation. We're going to glue a chassis into it, bolt it in conventionally. It's got an inch 350 shoulder, and thereby we're going to try to tighten that one up. That's in a 300W. No, I might have done that in a 300 Hellbringer. 300 WSM. We'll find that out as we go. That's not a problem. So now I'm going to pan down and I'm going to show you. I've referred to these. But here is the actual mess you're going to be seeing us working with. Let's see what I can do here for focus, see if we've got it good. See how we are down here. Okay, that seems pretty good. We're going to be using a tri-stock right here, which as you can see, this old guy, this is, any of you have watched my older videos or anybody that have seen, I've had this at a few matches. This is what a stock that I call my mule. This is the mule. It has been all over the place. It's been bedded and rebedded so many times. See if I can get, maybe bring this down and show you the inside of this guy. It's had every kind of action in it. It was I don't remember what it was originally built for, but it's had pandas, as you can see, bats. This is a test mule that I got way back in the day. This is one of my, so I'm going to leave this tilted a little so that you can see it. This is one of the first guns that I had built by someone else, trying to use someone else's skills because I was up against a wall with my own. And this old stock from back in the 80s, late 80s, early 90s, I have used forever. It's got a weighting system in the butt. Pretty extensive, but it's not much good for competition anymore because it's heavy, it's old school, It was the stock for heavy varmint in the 80s and up into the 90s. And I mean, it's still a good stock. But this particular one has been weighted and cobbled, and it's got so much glass inside of it now. It's been stiffened up so much. I've used it for everything from, for a long time, it was just a varmint gun. Then I got into long range, kind of long range, 600 and 1,000 yard competition shooting. And I started converting this. It's one of my, well, I call it a mule because it's a test platform. And right now, I'm going to kind of show you, you've seen glimpses of this before, but I'm going to try to explain exactly what I'm doing with the chassis systems that I'm going to be working with over the next little while as we work our way into this new system. You can see the chassis coming there. Again, I said it and said it and said it, but I just want to give you the focus of what we're leaning toward here, what we're trying to do, what we're trying to accomplish. We're trying to accomplish high strength barrel joints, something in the 150 PSI, 150 foot-pound range, which means removable, not glued in actions. In essence, in short, it means that I want to make conventionally bedded or removable or screw-in actions that shoot as well as a bench rest gun. I'm getting really close, but now I'm trying something. I'm going to do it in this stock and in that stock. These are bedding blocks that are going to get permanently affixed into the stocks. This one has been aligned and is pre-bedded and is ready now for me to glue it into place. Here is another one. I'm going to do two of these. I'm going to do this old stock and this newer state-of-the-art stock, and I'm going to do them both the same way. This is the way this action assembly goes into the stock then. And I'm going to go ahead and throw a barrel on it. I just chambered up the last barrel in my series today of my test barrels. So what's going to happen here? We're going to be testing a system in a heavy stock. This stock is over 7 pounds and it's weighted pretty butt heavy. This stock here is 20 some ounces, 22 ounces, I think. And with the block in it, I don't know what it's going to end up being, probably more like 24 or 25. We're going to set this up as a legal 10.5 pound bench rest gun, bolting. This one's going to be a legal 16 or 17 pound, 600 yard competition gun. And we're going to try 5 or 6 different methods. We've gone through some of these before. Some of these barrels that I've showed you before. This one, for instance, has got a shortened recoil lug. All of these have got shortened recoil lugs because they're going to end up fitting into this notch right here. They're bearing against aluminum. And this stuff will start to make sense as I start to put it together. To get everything to act the way I want it to, I'm experimenting. I've got about 9 different experiments running here. Now understand this, to all of you scientifically minded folks, when I say experiments, you've got to bear with me. I don't get paid to do this. I do this just because this is my passion and keeps me able to go to work again the next day. I'm sharing it only because I feel that it's important that some of this stuff be shared with the masses, because I'm not a scientist. I'm not a professional anything. Well, I'm a professional concrete guy. That's my business. I'm not trying to teach you anything. I'm not a purported expert on anything, but I am an inveterate experimenter, and some of my experiments have yielded some pretty fun results. My goal is not to teach you, it's to show you what I'm doing. Say, hey, I'm Al, I'm doing this cool stuff. Would you guys go out and do this? Would you try this stuff? And if you don't want to try it, at least watch me try it and decide, no, that's something I would never want to do. Or, yeah, that's an avenue I could see pursuing down the road. Yay or nay, doesn't matter to me. But that's one barrel system, and that's got a pull-down recoil lug. That's one of the things that we're going to be playing with. Because the problem inherent to the system is, on a glue-in system, this action is glued and affixed into the stock. It becomes a part of the stock. When the barrel whips, it transfers through the action. The action is actually the interface that ties the barrel to the stock by dint of the fact that this is epoxied into place. So we have a solid link. Now, to try to make that happen, there's a couple of things. One of the situations I'm going to try, for instance, this setup right here is going to have a free, one of these is going to have a free-floated tang. The whole tang assembly is just going to be hanging in the air, which means I've got one bolt right here. One bolt at the front of the action tying this whole thing together. Well, I'm not happy with that bolt. So I've also got a hole drilled in both of my chassis that goes down through the recoil lug so that I can put a pull down recoil lug in. That's what some of these experiments are. Now I have a bolt here and a bolt here. I've got a spread here between the two. Now the barrel starts to shake. The barrel is out here doing its thing. I'll just throw a barrel up here. When the barrel is doing this and trying to transfer to the stock, there's no longer just one bolt, but now there's two. And to get even more spread, this one I just did this morning. This I was just doing before I came here. This is an old, it's a 20-year-old barrel that I built as a 30-06 Ackley improved, or I had built years ago. And the whole project just fell by the wayside because what do I want a 30-06 improved for? Basically, I was just getting into the WSM. And I proved to my satisfaction that the 30-06 improved is roughly equivalent, but in a long action with the Lapua brass, and that was just another of my digressions. But when it was all said and done, here's a match grade barrel with very few rounds through it, and no reason for me to throw it away. So I'm converting it to another of my 300 WSMs, using my let's not even go there, 377 neck. This is the designation on my reamer. And on this particular one, I've got an interesting thing going here because this has got a turned off recoil lug to effect a shouldering assembly. We want to get the big shouldering assembly. Remember, I've been really high about that big shouldering assembly. Some of you will agree with me and understand that with the efficacy of that. Some of you are going to say, you're an idiot. Doesn't matter to me one way or the other, but there you can see, this is the last of the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 barrels I'm going to be testing on these two platforms. This big barrel, and this again is a testament to that 680 stuff. Last night when I wrapped up, I just chambered it this morning. I spun this shoulder down, threw the threads on here, ran this recoil lug on, and I had first knocked the corners off it on the mill, got it down to close. I ran this recoil lug on, stuck the other recoil lug on. This is the recoil lug that'll get used in the stock. Not actually this one because it hasn't been cut down yet, but a cut down one. So it's going to look like that from the top. The function of this is only to bridge the gap from this little tiny 1/100,000ths of bearing surface. This is now 680'd onto here. And all I did was last night I got a nice tight fit here. I degreased it, I cleaned it up, I put the Loctite 680 on there. I ran a recoil lug on and I ran a nut up on here and I just tightened up, left it overnight. Just drove this up against the shoulder and let it harden. This morning I came down and spun her up and turned that recoil lug off. See that surface right there? Now, it's roughly on the bottom, but when I get this torqued up, the problem with this pull-down system right here, when you think it through, is that it has to be set to an index to a certain place for it to work. If it's loosening up in any way, once you've torqued it down once, or if as threads start to wear, all of a sudden it wants to go past. So that barrel right now tightens down to about 70 foot-pounds. And then we're going to test the pull-down recoil lug. This, on the other hand, I turned this area off in such a way that, as you can see, I've got a nice big area here, a nice big lug area, and even where the pin goes through, even where the through pin goes through, I feel that I've left enough meat here that now I can torque this thing down. And even if it ends up torquing a little bit past center or a little bit different, that's not a problem for me, because if it torques in and it's sitting like this, at that point I just take my measurements, I come up from the bottom, I find my center line, and I'm going to drill and tap a little screw into here. I think I'm going to start with something really small. And it's going to be spaced quite a ways away from the pull-down screw on the action. So now I'm going to have two screws that are spaced this far apart, and they're going to be taking up the bending and the flexing and the lifting pressures. That's the latest of the, how do I say this, the latest fit on here so stinking tight. I just was just going to whip over here and put one in and screw this assembly together so you can see it. I'm going through quite a number of recoil lugs here. Okay, I cannot do this with it on there because of the way it's fitted. So, this is the single pull-down screw that I'm telling you about. We're going to eliminate this one on at least one of these setups. I think it's going to be this one. So the only thing holding this thing down would be this screw here. Now it'll hold down, it'll hold the recoil lug, it'll hold against, but when it tries to flex, when this assembly tries to do what I keep telling you that it's going to want to pull up out of the stock, let's screw this together while we're talking. This one now, once she's tightened down, it's going to go, that boss is going to roll around to where you're going to be able to, when we get this thing tightened down, we're going to be able to set it into the stock and line up a hole here. And now I'm going to get a pretty good separation between this screw hole and this screw hole. This far apart, and up here I'm going to put a pull down screw again. So I don't know, 648 or something. And I also have one of these set up to be pinched, to be threaded. It's somewhere in this mess. There's one of these that's got threads cut in it. Okay, I guess it's right here. If I can get it to come around. So, what we're striving to do here, just to bring everything into focus one last time before we start gluing stuff together and trying it. We're trying to get more screws to hold down and more separation between those hold down screws. We may or may not be using the rear hold down screw because we're leaving big open magazine holes. We're using actions that don't have a solid bottom. Common to the paradigm is with a solid bottomed action, we got a hold down screw here, we got a hold down screw here. And that gives a nice, stiff, rigid block section on the action to resist all the forces. Well, now we're eliminating, so we're trying to work with a piece up here. It's kind of like using a barrel block assembly. I'm trying to do almost a barrel blocking assembly, but I'm doing it with screws from the bottom. We're going to have a bunch of different sizes and types of screws and hold downs as we attempt to make these two stocks interchange. We'd have 6 PPC barrels to test, 6x47 Lapua to test, and 300 WSM to test in these two platforms using these You can't see the five barrels that are down here, but there are five barrels down here, five different assemblies, five different ways. This is not scientific. There's no double blind. There's no big samples. There's no, this is small sample. This is you seeing what I'm fiddling with today. And to all of you scientist types out there, don't go crazy on me saying that this isn't statistically relevant or valid. It's not. It is just the stuff I'm doing. Just sharing with you what I'm doing, the mindset. Here's that stack of barrels. That's what I was trying to do. We're just gonna put these together and we're gonna play with them. They're all completely different. And we're gonna try to make them all shoot. Try to figure out, because the thing we haven't even gotten into yet is the concept of tuning. Once you get the vibrations, once you've got a gun that's vibrating such that it vibrates consistently, then you can step up into something called tuning, which all occurs in the under 0.200 realm, under quarter minute of angle. Then we start tuning those vibrations. We can do it with loads. In this case, we're going to try to do it with some pull-down screws. We can do it with tunable muzzle brakes out on the end. Most commonly, it's been done with loads. You go to any match, guys are loading as they go, trying to stay on top of the conditions. And that's exactly what they're doing. They're trying to stay in a tuning window. So first we have to build firearms that are tunable and then offer good ways to tune them. And of course, all while maintaining my focus on removable situations, not glue-ins. We'll see how she goes.